Okay, I'd like to thank the organizers for the invitation to this wonderful conference. I'm enjoying the talks and food very much. So this talk is based on the work I have been doing with Richard Eger, Johanna Knapp, and Mauricio Romo. And this is also based on an earlier joint work with Manfred Herbst and David Page, which appeared in 2008. So the subject of this talk is boundary conditions in 2D 2.2 supersymmetric gauge theory. So this is obviously relevant for the study of deep brains in string theory. And this is also interesting a problem to study from the point of view of just from quantum field theory. Especially in 2D 2.2 is a place where two interesting dualities meet, and understanding or determining the correspondence between boundary conditions under these dualities is an interesting problem. And also, this can be regarded as an exercise for study of defect operators in higher dimensional field theories. So there is a very interesting class of theories called gauge linear sigma model, which was introduced to us by Edward Witten. And this theory has FI parameters. And this is decomposed into chambers called phases. And theory at each phase typically reduces to familiar theories like nonlinear sigma models, Landau-Ginzburg model, or Overfold, or of them, or hybrid of these two. And this space is complexified by theta angle. And quite often, this space is the modulized space of infrared superconformal fixed points. To be precise, this twisted chiral part of the modulized space. And it has a discriminant locus where Coulomb branch develops. And it is a lift of phase boundaries. And because this Coulomb branch is, discriminant locus is a complex hypersurface, so you can go from one phase to another by avoiding this discriminant locus. So you can go from one place to another without encountering a sharp transition. So we are interested in brains in this class of theories. And in particular, the low energy behavior of brain at each phase, and also how they are transported into each other along some path that avoids this singularity. About this discriminant. And there are two kinds of brains, boundary supersymmetric boundary conditions, A brains and B brains. Today I will focus on B brains. And these correspond, for example, in the case of nonlinear sigma model, to complex submanifolds of the target space or holomorphic vector bundles supported on these complex submanifolds. And the brains have RG invariant protected structure called category of brains. And this is like a boundary analog of chiral ring. And for the case of B brains, this is invariant under deformation of twisted chiral parameters. So we may consider parallel transport of this category of brains, say, on the space of FI theta parameters. And we can relate this category of brains in one phase to the category in another phase by going along along some path that avoids this discriminant locus. So describing this parallel transport using linear sigma model is one goal of my talk. So the great restriction rule, which is in the title, plays a key role in this parallel transport. This was first found in abelian gauge theories by Herbst and Page, a work with Herbst and Page, which I mentioned. And by using the hemisphere partition function, which are computed more recently, we would like to extend this rule to models in non-abelian gauge with non-abelian gauge groups. So let me start. So the data to specify a linear sigma model is a choice of gauge group G and matter representation V, superpotential W, and FI theta parameter. So this is exactly like 4D encoded 1 theories. Of course, the superpotential must be gauge invariant. And assume that the theory has two U1R symmetries, U1 vector and U1 axial, and also U1 vector has some charge integrality condition. So that means that you can assign R charge to chiral field so that the superpotential has R charge too. And for axial, G belongs to SLV of the representation space. And the D-brain in this, B-type D-brain in this theory is specified by the following data. First, we need to choose a Champaignton vector space and also matrix factorization of W. So M is a Z2 graded vector space, and Q, matrix factorization, Q is a function of this chiral multiplet field phi with values in the odd linear maps of M, such that whose square, the square of Q of phi is a superpotential times the identity. This Champaignton vector space must also be a representation of the gauge group G, so that the so that the matrix factorization Q is a gauge invariant. And also assume U1 vector R symmetry to be preserved. That means this vector space M is also a representation of this U1 R symmetry group, so that the Q has R charge 1. Okay, and I also assume charge integrality, which means this. So given this data, one can construct a boundary interaction. So this is essentially a Wilson line with a potential as written in here. Okay. But we need to specify boundary condition to the each component field, each fields. So this is the gauge field, and sigma is the scalar component of the vector multiplet. And for the chiral multiplet, phi and psi, you just need to impose the supersymmetric and gauge invariant version of Neumann boundary condition. For the vector multiplet, we need to impose the boundary condition, D-brain boundary condition for the scalar component sigma, which is valued in the complexified Lie algebra of the gauge group. So the D-brain has to be a Lagrangian sum manifold, which is a adjoint orbit of another Lagrangian sum manifold of the Cartan, which is Weyl invariant. So this follows from some analysis of supersymmetry. So the question is, which gamma for the vector multiplet boundary condition should be chosen? There's a very simplest choice, which is choose this to be a real locus. But there are infinitely many other choices. But we are considering theories without Coulomb branch, so we might think that choice doesn't matter so much. But we would like to know whether all these other choices are equivalent to each other, really, really equivalent to each other, or even whether there's some choice that makes sense at all. So we would like to know what kind of choices gamma can be or should be chosen. And a hint can be drawn by looking at the hemisphere partition function. So the hemisphere partition function, supersymmetric partition function on the hemisphere, can be defined as in the partition function on the two-sphere done by these people. And this can be computed exactly by Suzy localization. And the result is written as a contour integral of some function on the zero mode of the vector multiplet scalar. So let me show you the result. So let's first take the weight decomposition of the matter representation V and Champaignton vector space N. And this Ri and Qi, uppercase and lower cases, are the R charge and gauge charges of each component. So here is the result. So these are the one-loop determinants. This is from vector multiplet, and this is from chiral multiplet. This exponential factor, which is very important, just comes from the classical part, from the twisted superpotential, where T is this Fi theta parameter. And this Fb is what we call brain factor, which is a trace over this Champaignton vector space. So the result, the dependence of the brain is only through this gauge charge and R charge of this Champaignton vector space, not on this matrix factorization Q. And most importantly, this contour gamma is precisely the one that determines the boundary condition for the vector moment. So we want to use this to draw some lessons for which choice of gamma is the good one. And here is the proposal. So first, we want this integral to be absolutely convergent on this gamma. And second, gamma is homotopic to this. This is the real locus in the Cartan minus the pole locus, the pole of this gamma function in this formula, coming from the existence of zero mode of the matter field, matter kinetic term, matter scalar. Okay, so that's the proposal. And if you consider a theory deep inside the phase, such that the gauge group is broken to a finite group, then there's a master contour, a class of master contours that works for any choice of brain data. You just take some contour such that this exponential factor decays very rapidly at infinity. Then there is such a thing, as long as the gauge group is broken to a finite group. And if you compute it, you get some sensible answer, and you get something like a central charge of the brain if there's a super 4D n equal to 1 space-time picture. But the story is very different when there's a continuous unbroken gauge group. There's no such universal master contour that works for any representation, because this exponential factor is not strong enough. Rather, there's a non-trivial constraint on the brain. Existence of admissible gamma requires a non-trivial constraint on this gamma, on this brain. And this is the grade restriction rule in the title. So let me show you this in the simplest model, an interesting model, which is the model for the quintic. The model has U1 gauge group and six matter fields of these charges, and this superpotential determined by quintic polynomial F. And the theory has two phases, and in this phase, the gauge group is completely broken, and in this phase, gauge group is broken to Z5 subgroup. And this is a phase of nonlinear sigma model whose target space is a quintic Calabi-Yau threefold. And this is the Landau-Ginzburg orbital phase. And in between, there's a single discriminant point. Okay. So for this model, the integrand of the hemisphere partition function looks like this. So here, I'm looking at a term in the brain factor corresponding to the Champeyton gauge charge Q. And this part comes from the classical part, except for the finite shift, which is a quantum correction. But most important quantum correction comes from this damping factor. This comes from this gamma function. You can easily obtain it by looking at this Stirling's formula. And this exponent can be interpreted as boundary potential that is induced from matter multiplet. So let's consider the case where the zeta effective is positive or negative. So when it is positive, this is convergent region is essentially upper half line for any choice of Q. So if you choose the contour in this way, then it works. It is absolutely convergent for any Q. And for negative zeta effective, you just have to choose this. Then it works. So these are the master contours. But when this zeta effective vanishes, then the story is very much different. So we don't have this term, so we only have these two terms. And if this theta plus 2 pi q is too big or too small, then there is no actually admissible contour that satisfies this condition 1 and 2. But when this theta plus 2 pi q is within this interval, then the convergence region is like this. So you have a variety of choices. You can choose this, or this, or this. All these works. And you may consider going from positive zeta phase to negative zeta phase through some paths in the FI theta parameter space. So in the presence of the boundary, the theta parameter is no longer periodic. So we have this unwrapped picture of the FI theta parameter space. And we are going drawing some path that goes from here to here. So we must go through some window between the two. And the rule for the brain, for the Champeton weight, Champeton charge, depends on the window. So if you choose this path going through this window, then the Q must be one of these five charges. If you choose another window, then the Q must be one of this different set, must be a member of this different set. So this is the rule for this quintic example. Now let's move on to the main model of today's talk. So this is the model which I call Rudland model, and it has gauge group U2 and seven matters in the determined inverse representation and seven matters in the fundamental doublet under U2. So, and this, it has this superpotential given by this. So this bracket is SU2 invariant symplectic pairing. So under this, under U2, this transforms that determinant. So with this this combination is gauge invariant. So this quotient Aijk is some generic quotient which is antisymmetric in I and J. So it can also be written in this way. So the theory has two phases. And for zeta positive phase, the gauge group is broken completely. And the theory reduces to a nonlinear sigma model, whose target space is a submanifold of this Grassmannian G27, determined by these F-term equations. On the other hand, for negative zeta, the story is more interesting. At the vacuum locus, SU2 subgroup is totally unbroken by the value of the chiral modulet. So it is, you have to understand the SU2 dynamics to understand the low energy behavior of the theory. And this theory can be regarded as SU2 gauge theory, fibered over the space of P's, which spans CP6. And SU2 have seven doublets and have this superpotential. So this A of P plays the role of the mass matrix. To understand the low energy behavior of this, the relevant fact is the following. So this is also important, a non-trivial fact. So SU2 with a single doublet has no Suzy ground state. And also SU2 with three massless doublets flows to the free theory of mesons. So these two are most important facts to understand this linear sigma model in this phase. And if you use this fact, one can argue that the theory flows, reduces at low energies to the nonlinear sigma model, to the locus of P's, where the mass matrix has reduced rank, so that the massless doublets are exactly three. So this is actually a Calabria threefold called Puffian Calabria threefold. So I shall call these two phases as Grassmannian phase and Puffian phase. And I want to tell you also that there are three singular points in the, three discriminant points in the middle. Okay, so let me tell you the result about this grade restriction rule. But before that, let me just prepare some notation for the representation of the U2 gauge group. So I denote by S the fundamental doublet. Now, any finite dimensional irreducible representation of a U2 is of this form for L non-negative integer and I an integer. So this is Lth symmetric power of this doublet dressed by this charge I representation under the center U1. So this is the notation I'm going to use to label the representations. Okay. Now let me state the result. The easier part. In the Grassmannian phase, the U2 is completely broken. So there's a universal master contour that works for any representation. In the Puffian phase, there's a SU2 unbroken gauge group. So there's actually a non-trivial constraint for the convergence of the integral along in this SU2 direct part of this Cartan. And this requires this power L to be either 0 or 1 or 2. And otherwise, it is arbitrary. So we have only these three series that are allowed in this Parfian phase. So this is non-trivial rule in this phase, in the Parfian phase. Now let's move on to the rule for the path between the two phases. As before, this is unwrapped space of Fi theta parameters. And we can focus our attention to power L to be 0, 1, 2, because these are the only allowed representations in the Parfian phase. And also, because there are three kinds of singular points, there are different types of paths. Straight paths like this, or maybe curved path like this, or this, or this, or this. Okay, and we can describe the rule for each of them. So let me state the result. So for this straight path, only these 21 representations are allowed. For another path, curved path, a different set is allowed. For the another one, this different set. For another one, we have different. We have this different set. And if you move this path by 2 pi to the left, then the set is shifted one by one step to the right. And this works for any of the any class of paths. Okay, so this is the rule for this model. And I remind you that I said that for in the Grassmannian phase, for example, any brain is okay. There's a master contour that works for any brain. In particular, this brain may have components which is outside this, say, blue set, for example. Then you may ask, what happens to such a brain if we transport it along this blue line to the Parfian phase? So what happens? In fact, there's another brain, M prime, Q prime, such that M prime has components only in this blue set. And also, this has these two, this another brain, are equivalent to the original brain in the Grassmannian phase at low energies. Right, so there is some tachyon condensation that you can argue for that. And so, in other words, you can, before going through this path, we can replace this M by this M prime, M Q by M prime, Q prime. Then after replacement, you can safely, this can be safely transported along this blue path. So this M prime, Q prime at the Parfian phase is the result of the transport. And this replacement works for any of the other sets. And this also works also inside the Parfian phase. And the key for the replacement is the so-called empty brains. And this is the brain whose boundary potential Q and Q dagger anticommutator has always positive on the vacuum locus, so it is empty by the complete tachyon condensation. And for the Grassmannian phase, there's some explicit construction of empty brains using what's known as so-called twisted Lascaux complex. And for Parfian phase, there's another thing called Kaushuk complex. So another one important application of this result is the monodromy. So for the transport along a loop that encircles some discriminant point. Let's consider going from Grassmannian phase to Parfian phase along this path, then go back to the Grassmannian phase and along another path so that this loop encircles this discriminant point. The allowed set are different between these two paths. The difference is that so this C component, which was good in this path, is no longer good, but it is replaced by the C7. And so, if you start from a brain here, and so let's start from brain in the Grassmannian phase. Let's assume that it is already grade restricted with respect to this set, with respect to this path. Then after moving here, we want to replace it by a brain which is good for this path. So we need to replace this thing by that. And for this, you need some matrix factorization that is empty here. And there is some, such a thing called Kochu complex, which is made of these 8 representations. And you can attach or bind such empty brain at each copy of this, each C component of this original brain. Then the result is something made of these other components, which are good along this blue path. Okay. So this brain, empty brain, is empty in the Parfian phase, but actually non-empty in the Grassmannian phase. And in fact, this is actually a D6 brain wrapped on the Calabial threefold. And let me explain this. So this complex has this explicit realization using Clifford algebra. And the boundary potential you can easily compute, and it is of this form. And indeed, it is positive everywhere on the vacuum locus in the Parfian phase, and therefore it is empty. But it vanishes on the Grassmannian phase, it vanishes when p goes to 0, and when p is 0, and this goes to 0. And this is exactly the locus of this Calabial threefold. And it turns out that it is the, it gives you the D6 brain. So the outcome is that of this monodromy is that binding a number of copies of this D6 brain to the original brain. And this D6 brain is expected to be the one that becomes massless at this single this discriminant point in this picture of Andy Strominger. And for the other points, we can do the same. And for the second discriminant point, we replace this S to S of 7. For the third one, S2 of 6. So the result of the monodromy is binding a number of brains at each single point. So for this point, you get this line bundle, and for this point, rank 2 vector bundle, and this point, rank 3 vector bundles. Sorry, maybe I should stop, but let me just finish by telling you the key point in the derivation of the rule, which I have never, which I didn't talk about. So integrand looks like, asymptotically, like e to the minus I times the effective twisted superpotential. So this has a bunch of logs. This is like a sum of sigma log sigmas. So there are many branch cuts. But the level of the branch cut is actually specified by the Champeton representation. And exactly at this discriminant locus, there's a Coulomb branch on which this twisted superpotential is critical. But for generic choice of representations, this is the value is non-zero, and nothing special happens if you go around this. But this vanishes exactly for the distinguished pair of representations which appeared in the discussion of monodromy. And for such distinguished representation, the admissible region looks like this. And if you go away from the discriminant locus, the shape changes drastically. And for example, if one of the two representations is bad here, because the contour, good contour, is going through here, but it is broken by this. For the other, it is like a mirror image. So you can use this fact to show this rule, which I stated. Because my time is up, so I should finish here. Thank you for the attention.
So any question?
I'm not sure I understand the picture completely. The representation is a Wilson line along the boundary?
That's right.
So it's part of the definition of the brain?
That's right.
But the grade restriction rule means that the brain only is allowed with certain representations?
That's right. And depends on where you are in the FI theta parameter space. Because of this convergence.
But you had a region where all brains were allowed. All
yes, that's right. Allowed. That's right.
How do they, I'm sure you explained it, so I apologize for asking.
Sorry.
How did
Maybe I didn't explain well. So here is meant to be the explanation for this. So in the say Grassmannian phase, any brain is allowed. Okay, there's a master contour. But if you move this brain to the lower values of zeta, then it hits some value where this convergence breaks down. So what I want to do is, before going there, we replace it by another brain, which are equivalent at low energies deep inside this Grassmannian phase. Okay, and after the replacement, this can go through this.
So that's the crucial step. So for large zeta, although every MQ is okay, different ones are equivalent to each other.
That's right.
Because the group is broken to a finite group.
That's right.
So representations that are equivalent under the finite group are equivalent.
Right.
I'm not sure if it's related to what Ed was asking just now, but wall crossing phenomena I would have thought is relevant for your discussion, but I didn't hear anything about them.
Yeah.
I would have thought that the brains get decay to the other brains, and that's why you don't see them in some region, but I didn't hear anything.
Right, so I didn't say anything about wall crossing. This is about related to the stability of the brain, which I have not talked about at all. So this is maybe orthogonal to this, a priori orthogonal to this question about stability. But I'm giving you a description of brains, at least the definition of brains, everywhere in this FI theta parameter space. So maybe you can consider it as a starting point for the study of wall crossing, even near the phase boundaries.
But the information about these wall crossing is part of the data of detention of the brain. So
that's
part of what you're studying, this boundary integral.
That's right.
Nevertheless, it doesn't show up in the discussion. That's surprising.
Yeah, I didn't actually try to understand this study problem of stability. And this, of course, depends on the central charge of this brain, which is computed by this hemispherical partition function. So I'm sure that there's a way to use this result, but I haven't yet to get to this point.
Any other question?
Which part? The final one? Yeah. For example, let me just show you the simplest example where it is very easy to see for the U1. Yeah, for example, this. OK, so this is the integral. I'm considering some integral over sigma space over some contour, which has a continuous deformation of the real line. And if that this vanishes, we only have this term, and these are the convergence region. But if you want to start from the real line and then want to deform the contour to this convergence region, it hits the pole, for example.
And what's wrong with that point? So what happens?
So that means that, maybe it's not wrong. Rather, it is not. Right. So so the result of this is that you have this infinite sum of poles for this choice. So maybe it is not that it is wrong, but the description is more complicated.
I'll ask the question differently. Yes. Is your target space effectively compact?
Compact, yes.
Then where will you get the divergence from?
From the Coulomb branch, from the vector multiplet integration. So there's the Coulomb branch is lifted, but the boundary interaction have some part which gives you divergence if you just take this real locus as the contour. Or the deformation of the real locus.
But you change the functional integral only along one line.
One line, which one line?
Where your brain is.
Yeah, we are integration over this contour we have chosen. That's right. Yeah, over the contour, yes.
All right, so is there any other question?
Maybe I'm sorry. Sorry, I didn't perhaps answer it properly.
No more? All right.
One more. Mm-hmm. Sorry, I apologize. I have one more completely naive question. Mm-hmm. So you reject the representations where the integral would diverge.
Mm-hmm.
But is it completely clear that the object you're... okay, this is related to Natty asking if the space is effectively compact. So perhaps you've already answered. But maybe it's the observable that's wrong rather than the brain in the case of the wrong representations.
Right, maybe I should say, I said wrong representation for the choice of contour, which is of this class. Okay, maybe for this.